Ladies and gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen. We apologize for the slight delay. Some of the meetings are overlapping with each other, and that's why I want to also apologize on the behalf of our good friend, Abul Faz Karayev, the Minister of Culture and Tourism of Azerbaijan, who will be joining us in a few minutes because he's wrapping up another meeting that we were all tied up with. Once again, let me thank you all for being with us this lovely Baku afternoon. This particular session is focused on the sector and the activity of travel and tourism. It's entitled Harnessing the Transformative Power of Tourism in Building a Better Future and a Shared Responsibility. For those of you that are working in this field, you will probably be quite aware of what we're talking about. But for many of you that are not so involved or connected to the travel and tourism sector, you may find some of what we say a bit new to you. Why travel and tourism? What does travel and tourism have to do with dialogue, intercultural dialogue, and dialogue between different civilizations? How can travel and tourism contribute to making this world a better place? Particularly when we come to tourism, it may be a bit confusing. To many of you, the very word tourism, and to a big crowd outside of this room, does not convey a feeling of seriousness and ability of any activities connected to tourism to make a serious difference in the way we live. But that's precisely what we hope that you would change your mind about after leaving this room in an hour and a half that were given to us to do so. With us to do this is a very distinguished members of panels that will be helping me in trying to shed some light on the issue that's at hand here. To my right is a wonderful lady, Her Royal Highness Princess Dana Firas, President of the Petra National Trust. Petra is one of the most important, one of the most valuable human cultural heritage that mankind has ever seen. I come from Jordan myself, and that's why I know exactly the value of Petra. This fine lady, Her Royal Highness, has been dedicating all her life to protect Petra and to connect it with what is good in this world. Petra, this 3,000 years old heritage site, she's by far much more capable and qualified than I am in talking about it. But she's with us today, and we thank her very much for being with us here in Baku in Azerbaijan. We also have with us, Bill joining us shortly, Abul Faz Karayev, Minister of Culture and Tourism of Azerbaijan. I had a lot that I wanted to talk to you about, Abul Faz Karayev, but I think you'll understand if I keep it until he comes so he hears it firsthand. We also have with us Shaikha bint Mohammed Al-Khalifa. Shaikha is another wonderful lady. I believe that ladies are doing a by far much better job in this world than we are all doing here, the men in this room. Shaikha is the president of the Bahrain Authority for Culture and Antiquity, but she's also president of the Arab Regional Center for World Heritage under UNESCO. So she's the regional lady of UNESCO in the Middle East and in the Arab world. You have to go to Bahrain, you have to go to Manama, you have to go to Muharraq to find out exactly how Shaikha has actually changed the concept and the mindset of people there through the preservation, bringing back to life history, cultural heritage that was forgotten for years before, bringing it back to life, rediscovering and reinventing what was already there, but people did not know about. What she has done is incredible, and I'm very happy, very delighted to be here with us, and I thank her for being with us. Shaikha also, over and above this, has been named by the UNWTO, by the UN system, as the ambassador for the International Year of Sustainable Tourism for Development. Thank you very much, Sheikh Hamay, for being with us. We have also with us Mr. Fernando, the Deputy Minister for Tourism Development and Christian and Religious Affairs in Sri Lanka. Where are you, sir? Oh, you're on that side. You're next to the Sheikha. That's good. Now, for many of you that have not visited Sri Lanka, you would be amazed of how much this country has to offer. I had been in Sri Lanka 2-3 times. The last time I was there, I had an experience of a lifetime. Not because of the beautiful landscape only of Sri Lanka, which is amazing, but also because of the spirit of the people that are there. Sri Lanka is a country that's coming out of a long-term conflict, reconciling itself, and travel and tourism has been playing a major role in peace and reconciliation in the country of Sri Lanka. It's a country that we are learning so many lessons from, of how when you look at the world positively, all negative feelings within can become secondary. Thank you, sir, for being with us. We have with us also Thok Sokom, Director of the Department of International Cooperation and ASEAN in the Ministry of the King of Tourism in the Kingdom of Cambodia. And what can I say about Cambodia? Cambodia is another magic for any one of you that have not been to Siem Reap or many of the other archaeological treasures of the world. Should think again, never ever go about your journey of life without visiting Cambodia once in a lifetime. And I was not paid to make that commercial, I assure you. Cambodia is a wonderful place, and I'm quite sure that Mr. Sokom would be a good representative of so country. Again, Cambodia is a country, my generation and the generation of many people in this room that knows, 10, 15 years ago, Cambodia was a killing field. Cambodia is a country that's coming out of a conflict that was so vicious, so terrible. Today, tourism has changed the face and the way and the perception about Cambodia. We don't think of the days of the Khmer Rouge in Cambodia anymore. We think of Cambodia as a wonderful, beautiful place to visit and the wonderful people to receive you there. It's an example, and there are many lessons to learn from that. We also have with us Cohen Verlocket, Secretary General of the Flanders Department of Foreign Affairs. Now, many of you may not know where the Flanders are and how rich they represent. The Flanders are the backbone of Belgium. The Flanders are the people that inherited all the heritage of the First World War. I was in the Flanders and I was taken to some of the historical sites where mankind put to rest one of the most vicious, one of the most international conflicts that mankind has ever seen. The battles of the First World War were started and ended in the Flanders region. I'm very happy to have you with us. It's a long-time collaborator with UNWTO, and I'm sure your addition would be very valuable. Last but definitely, and by no means least, is Louis Damore. Louis Damore is the founder and the president of the International Institute of Peace Through Tourism. Louis Damore, 25 or 30 years ago, when he was still 10 years old maybe, started to connect peace to tourism. Louis Damore has dedicated his life to the issues of peace. Louis Damore is a pioneer in how to make tourism something that goes beyond the commercial and the business and the economic value of that sector, and to make it something that actually plays a bigger part in establishing world peace, stability. And we're very happy to have Louis with us. So we have 7 very distinguished panelists, and I'm only a moderator that has taken more than half the time in trying to present the good people that are with us on the panel. But I'm sure that you will, in whatever is left of our time, benefit tremendously from their presence here. So let me now start by posing some questions. What we will do is the following. I will pose a few questions for everybody to give 1 to 2 minutes response to first. Then we will want to engage you in dialogue with them. But first, I want to have them give them the opportunity to react to some of the more generic questions, and then we'll come back to them and be a little bit more specific about which questions are better related to their areas. So, let me pose a question to everyone now, and please prepare yourself. I have not given this question to any one of you, and I'm not going to stick to what I have here on this piece of paper. So please, within an hour, a minute to a minute and a half, if you can respond to what I want to say. How do you see tourism contributing to a cause that is bigger than the cause of its own profit, its own economic realm, contributing to making this world a better place from your own perspective, from your own area of work, and from your own area of interest? Princess Dana.
Thank you, Dr. Rifai. Seriously, thank you. At the Petra National Trust work for the preservation of culture and heritage and to find the balance that sometimes is evasive in public policy between tourism development and the needs of tourism development and preservation. The tension between these two is present everywhere, particularly in archaeological sites. But what we have also found that it's not only a tension, that there is, in our experience on the ground in Jordan, that tourism has actually provided us with a platform through which we can do several things. One, improve participation, so reach people at any level, from the decision-making level all the way down to the local community level. So tourism provides us with the space through which we can engage and through which people can participate. I'm going to be very brief and not go into detail so that I stick to my minute. It gives us the opportunity for innovation and creativity. Culture is always tied to innovation and creativity and fostering innovation and creativity in people and in youth. We have seen this in our experience in Petra, but more importantly, we see it very much in the tourism field, and we see it in the space that tourism can create for people to come up with ideas take control of their own development and of their own ideas on how to manage between tourism development and cultural preservation. So this is the space that tourism provides. It really is an opportunity for prosperity. Tourism provides jobs, but even beyond that, what it provides is this link. It provides a link that is historical and that is on multi-dimensions is what I'm trying to say. Historically, if you go back through history, you said 3,000 years, but it's actually 10,000 years. So Petra has a human settlement in Beida that is 10,000 years old, and it goes back to the Neolithic times. That settlement has examples of architecture which are relevant to us today, from 10,000 years ago. That settlement has examples of agriculture, bread making, that we actually still use to this very day. So there is this continuum of lessons learned, of culture, of history that can be preserved, but tourism provides us the opportunity to translate it, to bring it forward to today and make it relevant for people who come seeking a cultural experience. It makes the place unique, it gives it its own sense of a special experience, and that can only come out through culture preservation, does the link, does the documentation, and is valuable, but it's tourism that offers that opportunity to bring that out. And then the modern day links, the links between people from throughout the world who come in and who live and walk in the footsteps of others who are different from them, others who live differently from them, and learn that at the end of the day, we are all very much more, we have more in common than we have things that make us different. So it's the tourism that provides also this platform for this interaction, for this understanding, for the opening of minds. I'm going to stop here, and I can elaborate further, but I think I've gone over my minute.
No.
So
since you have been quite accurate in your response, I'm going to take the liberty of following up that with a short question, which I will do with all other participants as well. How do you see your experience in Petra contributing to intercultural dialogue, whether it's by telling the historic story or by modern day interaction between visitors and local people?
I think it's both. It's a combination of both. One of the we've noticed that visitors who come to Petra come seeking a cultural experience. They see this beautiful site in pictures, but it's the actual cultural experience that enriches the visit. So they want to learn more about people who currently are living in the Petra region, the current Jordanians, but they also want to learn about the people of the past. Mm-hmm. And so this link that shows you how people used to live, what they used to believe in, how they used to worship, how they used to eat, how they buried their dead, is very interesting to a visitor. And it shows you how very similar we are today and to so many things, so many practices that existed in the past. So this similarity really does cement very practically the idea that we are the same. The civilizations that have come through Petra have come from throughout the world. They've, you know, the people of all sorts of ethnic backgrounds, all sorts of traditions, and so many of them are very similar to the backgrounds, to the traditions of people who come and visit. And so this historical continuum that highlights our shared human values, the things that make us who we are, that build our identity today, really are all rooted in values that globally are very similar and that we all share as civilization. So that's one thing. Also, people are very curious about who are these Jordanians? Who are the people who inhabit the caves of Petra? Are they strange? Are they the same as we are? And often this interaction provides this opportunity to say, you know, to show the real face and to show that it's very, very friendly, open, welcoming, engaging society and has still today a lot to offer to the visitors, a lot of interesting habits and backgrounds and religious beliefs and traditions that they practice that I think people are curious to see. So it does bring together people very practically on a day-to-day basis as well. I think it's a combination of...
Thank you so much, Your Royal Highness. Sheikh Hamay, I would ask your permission to go directly to a contrasting experience and keep you for a later intervention. I want to contrast what's happening in Jordan with Sri Lanka, if you don't mind. So, Mr. Fernando, how would you answer the question about how do you see value in your visitation?
Yeah, thank you very much. One of the topics that we discuss here is how can power of tourism as an agent for peace and reconciliation be harnessed? Now, when you talk about reconciliation, now Sri Lanka is a country, as you said, like we were after 30 years of war, 3 decades of war, and Sri Lankan government managed to defeat the number one terrorist group in the world. And this war was in the northern and eastern parts of Sri Lanka. And it was between the government and this terrorist group. But when you go to the cause of the problem, it was actually between the majority Sinhalese and the minority Tamils. The minority Tamils in 1983, with the riots, they migrated to countries like France, Germany, Australia, Switzerland, etc. So now the people who migrated from Sri Lanka in 1983, the minority Tamils, are doing well in these countries and they are very rich. And now after the war, since we managed to get rid of the war, we were opening these areas, the northern end is the place where we have a lot of beaches, where you can come and invest in these places. Now, a real cause for this problem is the poverty. And also, like, the people are not asking for separate state. The minority Tamils living in my country, they are not asking for a separate state. They are asking for better jobs, good education, good health, and also, like, a peaceful living. So we are asking all these rich Tamils living in these European countries to come and invest in the northern and east of Sri Lanka to build hotels, then it will create more jobs to the minority Tamils. So it will be, that is how we are looking forward to have peace in those areas with good living condition for the minorities. So, like, right now, we ask all the Tamil diaspora and anyone who can come and invest in northern and east of Sri Lanka, where we had this problem, where we had 30 years of war, to come and invest and to have the tourism as a tool to have a better future for those people. So that is what we are looking forward.
Sir, in a nutshell, how do you see your modern day experience in reconciliation contributing to intercultural dialogue with other societies and other people outside of Sri Lanka?
Right now, like since 2009, there have been like very like number of tourists are coming like if you our target was 2 million annually, and we are doing more than that now. So like Sri Lanka is a place where you have multi-religious, multicultural, like in Azerbaijan. Now, if I give you an example, say like Sri Lanka, there are religious tourism in Sri Lanka. Like if you take Hinduism, now Hindus believe in two books, Mahabharata and Ramayana. If you take Ramayana, in Ramayana, there are 14 holy places. Out of that 14 holy places, 11 places are in Sri Lanka. So all the Hindus, like say, if you take Hindus, there are Hindus in India, there are Hindus in UK, everywhere in the world. So we are, it's one of the examples that we are telling you that multi-religious and multicultural things have given us to develop tourism in Sri Lanka, so that the tourism, in fact, give the better chances of developing the country, the economy. Because the Sri Lanka, as you all know, right, Sri Lanka is a country that we have 70% of poverty life. So we have to get rid of that, we have to develop the economy. The main resource that we have is our diversity in Sri Lanka.
So what you're saying is your emphasis on the economics. By improving the economic situation of the people, they'll become more capable of interacting better with the outside world and improving.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you so much. Can I contrast that, if you don't mind, with the experience of Cambodia, a modern day conflict that was resolved in not a very easy way, and how is tourism now contributing to better life and better world and better interaction image of Cambodia abroad, please?
Thank you. For Cambodia, like Excellency Secretary General just mentioned, about 20 years ago, not many people know Cambodia. So we, because we have many group of Khmer people living at the border and fight against the government. So after 1998, that we fully reconciled from different group that try to fight against the central government, like not different from Sri Lanka. So from those days, under the win-win policy of some like Akep Mahasenapati Dacho Hun San. He set out the sound policy to negotiate with the Khmer Rouge, and finally we restored peace and political stability. So from there, we have tourism, you know, seen that the Khmer Rouge was defeated in 1979, and we have a very long year of war. This is the influence of the Cold War. It's not about the Khmer themselves that fighting against each other. So this is about the influence of the Cold War. So from there, we can see what is after war. All soft infrastructure, hard infrastructure destroyed, completely demolished. So we together try very hard, you know, from 1979 up to 1993. The day we work, at night we fight against the Khmer Rouge. So through those years, we try our very hard life and no tourism. So after 1998, that we have tourism that come back to life or revitalized. So we can see that we all together have been trying very hard, try to seek the assistance for development from UNWTO, UNDP, so on and so forth, to train our people, because no one know. But tourists already came into Cambodia, but no one know about hospitality. No infrastructure, we just have few hotel. But now, the win-win policy, the sound policy of the government that made tourism on the right track, that we, however, is not yet successful, but we work together because we have law and regulation. We must make law and regulation for the shared responsibility. So those, we have the shared responsibility and advisory responsibility, and that is very important, that we can advise and we can have our prime responsibility. So from there, I would like to bring you that we would like to have shared responsibility among our people in the region. Like, I think maybe some of you here know that ASEAN, for the Southeast Asian Nation Association, that we try to make a policy for the region to, you know, that tourism services and facility need to be standardized. So then we have the ASEAN tourism standard. So we have many. So then I see the topic is set responsibility. That is very good that we not only working for the nation, Cambodian nation, but we also working toward the region. And I think that we will work toward for the global responsibility. So then I think under the wise leadership and wisdom of Dr. Taleb Rifai would be, we can find a sound mechanism that we can work together and with the set, under the set responsibility. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I'll come back to you with another question, but I'll want to go back to Bahrain now. And then if you don't mind, I'll go to the Flanders, Azerbaijan, and I'll keep the best for last for Louis Damouri to make a icing on all of this. So if you don't mind, Sheikh Hamay, could you be kind enough to tell us a little bit, how do you see your work as contributing to enhancing and upstaging the image of Bahrain, and how did it contribute to the pride and sense of ownership of the people in Bahrain to what they have and their culture and their history?
Thank you very much, Dr. Taleb. If you allow me to speak in Arabic, if you don't mind, to answer in Arabic.
love that.
إذا أردنا أن نتحدث عن خصوصية البحرين وكيف تقدم نفسها
Sorry, is there a problem? There is interpretation. There is interpretation, no? There is interpretation into Arabic. What you need to do is use this. And I'm ready to give this up myself if anybody wants it. Okay. Channel two, please. Channel two. All right. شيخ حمي, please.
نكمل دكتور طالب عن الخصوصية وكيف تقدم البحرين نفسها للعالم. لابد من تكامل قطاعين هامين. وأعتقد أنكم في المنظمة العالمية للسياحة وفي اليونسكو قد عقدتم مؤتمرا خاصا بهذا الشأن في كمبوديا حضرناه قبل عامين يركز على أهمية تجميع القطاعين أو العمل بصورة متكاملة لكي نقدم الصورة الأمثل لاستقطاب سياحة نوعية. نحن في البحرين نعتز بأننا نملك حضارة تعود إلى 5000 عام ونملك خصوصية تميزنا عن سائر الدول الخليجية الأخرى أو دول المحيط. لو وظفنا هاتان الخصلتان أو الصفتان التي تميز البحرين لاستطعنا أن نستقطب سياحة نوعية. نحن نريد أن نرتقي بالخدمات التي تقدم, لا نريد أن نكرر التجارب الناجحة حولنا. نحن في إقليم المسافة بيننا الزمنية بالطائرة أقل من ساعة, نستطيع أن ننتقل من البحرين إلى دبي إلى أبوظبي أو إلى غيره. ماذا نقدم لكي نستقطب؟ بعد عامين لدينا إكسبو دبي 2020, هي فرصة ذهبية لمملكة البحرين لكي تستقطب سياحة نوعية. ماذا نقدم لمن سيرى في دبي كل المميزات التي يوفرها المكان؟ واستطعنا أن نستعرض مع القائمين على الإكسبو. سوري, هل أكمل؟
Is there a problem? Maybe you're going too fast. Yes, yes, yes. There is a problem?
No. Second channel. Second
channel two, please. Channel two. بس ممكن يمكن شوية أبطا عشان.
أبطا, okay. نكمل. الخصوصية هي ما يتميز أي بلد. نسافر من بلد إلى آخر لكي نرى ما يتميز بهذا البلد. على سبيل المثال, حين نأتي إلى أذربيجان المرة الأولى ونكرر زيارتنا مرة أخرى مع عائلة أو مع مجموعة من الأصحاب لكي نقدم لهم شيئا آخر تتميز بهذه البلد. في البحرين أيضا لدينا ما يميزنا, نحاول أن نرتقي بالأحياء التي ربما هجرها أهلها وأن نعيد الحياة لها وأن نوظف سياحة نوعية ترتقي بمستوى الخدمات التي تقدم للأهالي. أيضا نرتقي بالأحياء, نوفر فرص عمل ونقدم ما يميز هذا البلد لكي يستقطب سياحة نوعية. هذا ما نسعى إليه في الثقافة, ولا بد من تكاملها مع السياحة لكي نروج بالطريقة الصحيحة. لا أستطيع أن أروج لبلد دون أن أقدم خصوصيته. الترويج مهمة ومسؤولية, وتقديم أي بلد للعالم لكي نستقطب الآخر ليزورنا لابد أن يكون على أعلى مستوى وعلى خصوصية معينة. لن نكرر التجارب الأخرى وإنما نقدم خصوصيته. هذا ما نراهن عليه. نراهن على الثقافة, نراهن على النوعية, نراهن على الجودة. نريد أن تكون البحرين بوتيك ديستينيشن. هذا ما نسعى إليه.
شكرا جزيلا. Thank you very much, Sheikh Hamay. Come back to you with another detailed question.
Okay.
But before we do that, I'd like to go to another part of the world, to Europe. Flanders, you have a very unique experience that is dominating the first half of the 20th century. Could you please elaborate how that would have contributed to the world knowing you better and you understanding the world better? What are the lessons that we have shared together in trying to showcase to the world, please.
Thank you very much. First of all, Mr. Secretary General, I want to thank you for very actively promoting Flanders. One statement by you about Flanders is worth much more than any commercial campaign, so many, many thanks. As you said before, Flanders is the northern part of Belgium, and the name of the region is forever linked to Flanders Fields, which was a concept written down in a poem by a Canadian medical surgeon during the First World War, John McCrae. It's a poem which is known all over the world, and it's a symbol for one of the major battlefields during the First World War, which was situated in the northern part of my country, in the region of Flanders. It was a very devastating conflict, as you all know. Just a couple of characteristics which I want to share with you. It was the first place in the world where chemical warfare took place with gas attacks. It was the first case of wanton destruction of cultural heritage, which is once again these days a very hot topic in heritage conservation. It was also one of the first times that the war effort was heavily mechanized. And in total, more than 500,000 soldiers from more than 50 present-day countries died in Flanders Fields during the First World War. So when we saw the centenary of the First World War coming up in the period 2014-2018, the government of Flanders really saw this as an absolute unique opportunity to develop a kind of visitor economy, taking into account, and that was one of the very big challenges, on the one hand, the economic and the commercial interests, which always play a role, of course, if you talk about visitor economy, but at the same time also taking into account the ethical dimension, because visiting a battlefield, visiting a military cemetery, visiting memorial sites is not the same as going to a kind of exhibition, to a kind of fair. So we are still progressing with the commemoration. We still have 1.5 year to go, but we are already with our thoughts beyond 2018, and together with some colleagues in other places of Europe, and more specifically in the Basque country in Spain, and also with our colleagues from Northern Ireland, Flanders really wants to leave a lasting legacy, trying to summarize the lessons that we have learned and the experiences we have gathered with the commemoration of the First World War. So Flanders, Northern Ireland, and the Basque Country, we have teamed up. We are working closely together with UNWTO, and once again, many thanks for helping us in this regard. We are currently running a research project which will culminate in some concrete recommendations to the UNWTO General Assembly, which will take place in Chengdu later this year in September. And what are these lessons or these recommendations about? It's about, very briefly, first developing some what we call ethical guidelines for tourism to conflict-related sites from the past. Those ethical guidelines would try to give some more background for different categories of people, including the host communities where those sites are situated, but also individual visitors, also the site managers, whether they are public or private, and also the big industry of tourism service providers. Secondly, we want to develop a policy framework for public authorities, trying to help them, trying to inspire them in developing a kind of peace-sensitive policy framework. And finally, we also would like to contribute in connecting, what I would call connecting the dots between so many different disciplines, which also, for example, within the UN system or intergovernmental system, are the responsibility of separate agencies or separate organizations. I'm talking about connecting the dots between tourism, heritage, culture, education, research and development, and so on. So this is what we try to do with the view for the period beyond 2018.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Cohen. I will come back to you on a specific question with regard to the project that you're doing on developing ethical guidelines in visitation of historical sites of conflict, because that's something that we could draw some parallels for in other places around the world, mm-hmm. and it does reflect on how we understand and how people would understand us when they visit us. But at this point in time, I want to come to our host country, Azerbaijan. And Mr. Garayev, a good friend, I refrained from introducing you in your absence. because I thought that you should hear what is being said about you. You're a person that managed to bring all of us here. We know that you are the driving force behind the logistics and the running of the day-to-day activities of this very important forum, and we thank you very much for it, because Azerbaijan is a modern-day success story. But can you please answer the question that I posed at the beginning, which is very simply, how does the tourism policy in Azerbaijan and what Azerbaijan has to offer contribute in tourism terms to the dialogue between civilizations and intercultural dialogue? Thank you.
Thank you, Excellency. First of all, thank you for kind words regarding Azerbaijan organization, and it's our pleasure to have all of you here. And thanks to the regulations of the statistics of tourism all over the world, you gave your personal impact to the figures. Arranging such kind of events, we have all of you like a tourist here, so mostly welcome to enjoy Azerbaijan like a destination. We consider that the history of tourism of Azerbaijan is quite young, but during these years we tried to put our country on the map of tourism with different encouraging projects, ideas, and thanks to the support of the World Tourism Organization, which we heavily evaluate, we are moving dedicatedly and sustainable. Today we had a chance to, I was there to participate at the meeting between His Excellency Taleb Rifai and the President of the country, His Excellency Ilham Aliyev. And during this meeting, our President said to Taleb that every year visit brought some innovation to tourism of Azerbaijan. Because every time you were meeting with me, you gave the idea, which we implemented, and the result is in front of your eyes. These meetings are really something which encouraged the state to consider tourism is one of the most important and the biggest non-energy industries in the country. Today, when Azerbaijan is the country which is bringing oil and gas to the international market, tourism is giving 4.1% of GDP, and of course here we understand that we still have big potential. We try to combine the potential of Azerbaijan, the traditional hospitality, which is the background, the main standing background of the whole activity, traditional hospitality of our people, with the beautiful nature, with the historical monuments, with the tolerance, with understanding, and we are ready to share this experience through such kind of event we have now. But the industry is still looking for the targets and the ideas which will bring some certain peculiarity of Azerbaijan in the world of tourism market. We consider that the vision of the country like the bridging cultures, bridgings, bridging religions, bridging ideas, the place where you can share your feelings and thoughts and express your feelings without thinking that it will not be understood. Because the traditional history of Azerbaijan permits us to base this understanding like the focal point of the industry in itself. So from this point of view, again, I would like to appreciate the support to the idea of the forum through UNWTO, your active participation, and still we have a lot to learn from our experienced friends, neighbors. Azerbaijan is only 25 years old on the map of independent states. So we had wars, we had destructions, we had occupations until now, and only in 2001 we started to think about tourism like an industry. And that time the portfolio of the ministry was giving to the Minister of Youth and Sports, and since that time we started preparations of the programs. So every year brought us some new impression, new experience, new feeling, and new vision. We still are looking for the final ideas, but the final ideas are coming with us, living with us daily. We create special tourist zones now, according to your advices. We are doing dedicated programs concerned with the European market, with the Middle East market, with the Far East market. And I must say that today we are happy to see here in Azerbaijan numerous guests coming from the Gulf countries, because we are linked to the by the distance, we are linked by the aviation possibilities, we are linked by the traditions and religion, and we feel that the newcomers from the Arab countries feeling us ourselves very comfortable here. We are proud of that, but we still looking forward to have more tourists from European countries, from Far East, and we are working in this direction. What is the matter of the biggest attraction in Azerbaijan? I can't say because you have to see yourself, feel it, and I hope that during the next couple of days you will have this chance. And then we will looking forward for your new advices. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Minister. I would like to come back to you at some point after we listen to Louis Damore on the issue of this forum and how you want to see yourself as a bridge between East and West, and how is that connected to tourism. But first I want to thank you for reminding me of what I keep hearing always from Sheikh Hamay, describing tourism as the oil that never runs out. And that's what you have developed here in Azerbaijan. Now, can I just turn back to Louis Damore? Louis is a person that dedicated himself for the cause of peace and tourism. Louis, you've heard everybody here speaking about a conflict, whether it's First World War, whether it's the Khmer Rouge and the regional conflict in Cambodia, whether it's the civil war in Sri Lanka, whether it's the conflicts in the Middle East, and so on and so forth. And what Minister Garayev also referred to when he spoke about wars and atrocities historically here in Azerbaijan. What made you think of the idea of connecting tourism to peace? And how do you see that contributing to the intercultural dialogue, Louis? Louis is based in Montreal, Canada, and he's having a very important and big meeting in mid-September on peace and tourism to commemorate a very important anniversary for him. But I leave that to you, please, Louis.
Thank you, Taleb. I will answer your question. But first, I would like to publicly thank you for all that you have done in your 8 years as Secretary General to use tourism, to foster tourism in making the world a better place. To answer your question, from about 1976 to 1986, I was a futurist to the tourism industry in Canada. And in the early 80s, after looking at tourism through a North American lens and everything looking very positive for the future of tourism, I began to look at tourism through a global lens. And when you did that, you began to see a future where there was increasing gap between the have and have not regions of the world. You saw a deteriorating environment. You saw the growth in terrorism and a number of other global issues, such as the beginning of climate change. So rather than continuing to work on looking at the future and what its implications were for tourism, I thought maybe we could flip this around and ask, how can tourism contribute to a better world? And so in 1986, we began promoting an international conference on tourism and peace. And that first global conference in Vancouver first introduced the concept of sustainable tourism. The Institute was born with a vision of travel and tourism becoming the world's first global peace industry, and the belief that every traveler is potentially an ambassador for peace. We have three major initiatives underway in the current year. One is a Travel for Peace campaign. This will promote our credo of the peaceful traveler, which is a beautiful poetic statement which you can find on our website, iipt.org. And along with that, a portrait of the global family by Padre Johnson, who traveled around the world for 13 years, visiting every country, living and breaking bread with people and sharing stories and drawing portraits of the people that he met with. He did 24 portraits of different people he met with in different regions of the world, and he put them all together in what he calls his global portrait in travel with the global family. This portrait of the global family with our credo of the peaceful traveler is what we are promoting in our Travel for Peace campaign, and we welcome all of you to join us in that. We also have a global peace parks project, which has its foundations in a project we did in Canada for Canada's 125th birthday, 350 cities and towns dedicating a park to peace. And I'm pleased to say that Dr. Rifai has joined with us since then in dedicating parks to peace at the start of the last two global assemblies. We are continuing that now with a Global Peace Parks Initiative. And again, we welcome each of you to join us in that. And the third initiative is what you mentioned, a global summit in Montreal as one of the official conferences of the UN International Year of Sustainable Tourism for Development and Peace. And we are co-organizing that with the UN World Tourism Organization. And we thank you and the UNWTO for your collaboration on that, Taleb. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Louis. IIPT stands for International Institute of Peace Through Tourism, just for you to be familiar with that. Thank you so much, Louis, for all your efforts and dedication. I guess the work of Louis, and that's why I kept him to the end, is the most concrete manifestation of how can tourism contribute to intercultural dialogue and to peace in this world, because that's what he is directly doing, as opposed to many of the people around this table that are approaching this from a national perspective. He's approaching it from an international perspective, per se. Okay, now, I have a set of other short questions to all the panelists, but I'm going to stop at this point and turn it back to the audience. So please, if you have any one or two questions, ideas, remarks, but please be specific and refer to some of what's being said or to any of the panelists in particular before I come back to my set of questions that will be the final round. So now the turn is yours. Anybody would want to start? I know the first question is always the most difficult, but yes, please. Would you be kind enough, each one of you, to introduce yourselves and then, yes, we need a mic if you, a mic? You can come and use this.
I can speak louder.
Okay, you can. But then there will be no translation, huh?
No, there will be.
But it's in English anyhow, I assume. Please, go ahead.
Sir. My name is Ambassador Wafak Ajouri from Jordan. I have three short questions. One for Her Royal Highness, one for Dr. Rifai, and one for His Excellency Mr. Shaikh. Your Highness, how could a beautiful girl come from Australia and fell in love with a Bedouin in Petra and get married and have children?
This is the first question. Second question.
Sorry. My name is Ambassador Muwaffaq Ajlouni from Jordan. I have three short questions. The first question to Her Royal Highness Princess Dana. How could a beautiful girl coming from the end of the world, from Australia, to Jordan and fell in love with a Bedouin and get married and have children? My second question to Dr. Rifai.
Which is what happened, I'm assuming.
It happened, really. This is a fact. My second question, how could monks and last monjas and priests coming from Vatican, from Chile, from other parts of the world, and live for weeks, for months, in the sites of Baptist in Jordan, near the Jordan River? And my last question to His Excellency, how could tourism contribute to peace in occupied land like Nagorno-Karabakh and Palestine? Thank you.
Thank you so much. I could see that the first two questions are a direct translation to your mandate as a promoter of Jordan. Your Royal Highness.
Well, I guess one cannot but fall in love with a Jordanian man. But, you know, there is, it's human nature. There are certain values, human values that we all share. Love is a universal value. And again, this is something that across cultures, this is like a universal human value that we all share across cultures. So I think these stories exist everywhere. This is absolutely a true story. And you know, the universal story of love and intercultural bonds, I think, is, you know, I'm going to leave it at that. I don't know what else to say. The rest of it, I'm not very qualified to comment on.
It's an intelligent answer.
Thanks.
Ambassador, regarding the baptism site, I guess what we should be talking about here in a more generic term is religious tourism. Because religious tourism can have a powerful impact on bringing people together. People coming from different cultures. Religious tourism is not just about you visiting the sites of your own religion. It's not just about pilgrimage and visiting your own monuments and your own shrines. It's about us visiting every other religious temple, shrine in the world. When my wife and I were in Sri Lanka, we had a memorable experience in a Hindu temple and a Buddhist temple that were next to each other. It was a moving experience to us, and we learned a lot. And I completely believe that what we are talking about, what you're describing that happened in the baptism site, is probably a translation of how religious tourism, if we promote it the right way, can become a very powerful vehicle of cross-cultural understanding. What we heard this morning about Islamophobia or other phobias can very easily be addressed through more people visiting more sites, respecting these sites, and behaving and learning from them the right way. Mr. Garayev.
Thank you very much. To tell you frankly, the question addressed to me is quite complicated because there is no answer which will satisfy everyone. Unfortunately, the modern world is still bringing such barriers which are very hardly overcoming by anyone. Occupation is something which is bringing instability and sustainability, difficulty, not only for the country which suffers from that, for the people living there, but for entire world and for the surrounding countries. That's why we highly appreciate the impact given by the Executive Council and the General Assembly of the WTO, which accepted the proposal of the Ethic Committee of World Tourism Organization concerning recommendation not to promote the destinations which are under the occupation and other difficulties which will not permit the governing bodies to secure the people going there. It may be disasters, illnesses, national disasters, and so on. But occupation is the matter which is really badly and negatively influencing to the development of tourism. And in this case, we have to apply not to only to the unions and organizations dealing with tourism or humanitarian understanding, but more to the politicians, more to the military unions, more to the heads of states, and so on and so on. Until the peace and the understanding will not be reached at the place where we are going, it will not be recommended to go there for anyone. As today we had experience from your word, Taleb, you said, that people are traveling to the place where they feel themselves safely. When you go to the place where you feel tension and you don't feel yourself comfortable, you will never find in your mind the idea to go to this destination. That's why, first of all, in the countries which are suffering under occupation, must be achieved the political solution. We have this experience here in Azerbaijan, where 20% are under occupation of our neighbors. But we are living in the modern world. We know the communications. We have a lot of, vehicles to deliver the beauties of these places, the nature of these places, the traditions of these places. And I think that today we have used these vehicles to bring the information to each other. I would like to say that I will recommend personally not to go to the places which are under the conflicts today, especially when we cannot secure the stability and safety of those people who are going there.
Thank you, Minister. We will take two more questions from the floor. Yes, please. If you be kind enough to introduce yourself, that would be.
Yes, my name is Albert Kandapa, and I represent Ghana. Yes, from the Embassy of Ghana in Madrid, next door to you, General Secretary. Yes, my question is to the gentleman from Cambodia and Sri Lanka, based on which I would want you to also come in, the General Secretary. How have you two used tourism to fight the global perception about, for instance, Cambodia? You mentioned Cambodia, and what comes to mind is the dreaded Khmer Rouge. But how are you using tourism to tell the world that Cambodia is not all about Khmer Rouge, and that the people of Cambodia and, of course, Sri Lanka are also peaceful people, and it's not all about the Khmer Rouge or the Tamil Tigers? And Mr. General Secretary, do you think tourism should be agenda-driven, for instance, in the case of Cambodia? Can they use tourism to smash the perception that Cambodians are not all about Khmer Rouge? Do you think tourism should be agenda-driven, or you think we should just tell the story as it is and not drive it towards a certain end? Thank you.
Thank you so much. I will respond to that, but first I'm going to ask our very good friend Fernando from Sri Lanka to respond, and then...
With your question, and also the way I stopped earlier, like Sri Lanka, as I said, not only Hindu and not only Buddhism, and also Islam, Christianity. Now I'm the Minister of Tourism and Christian Affairs. My father is a Christian, mother is a Buddhist, and I'm doing tourism and Christianity. Both, like Sri Lanka is into religious tourism, and also Sri Lanka is a beautiful place and all with a lot of diversity. We are promoting Sri Lanka with a theme of 8 experiences in 8 days. So now all these conflicts that we had before with all these terrorist problems and also these minority issues, we are like, it is the past. Now we are focusing on developing tourism. When we develop tourism, it will affect the economy of the country, and it will benefit all the people in the country, not only the majority Sinhalese, minorities, all the people who are in all the religions, all the nationalities, because the poverty is the most important thing that we have to eliminate from my country. For that, one of the resources, we have a lot of potential with tourism, so we are using tourism as a tool for that. So, and also, like, now, if you take example, all these Middle East countries, now they are coming to Sri Lanka because Sri Lanka is an island, the coastal, there's a nice beaches in the coastal area, and also in the middle, we have the cold climate with mountains and waterfalls. So, like, we have wildlife, then sanctuaries, then also, like, sports. If you come to sports, tourism, we have all these sports introduced with the influence of British, cricket, rugby, and also, like, golf. Then white water rafting. Then we have this all these sports with the sea and marine archaeology, a new field in Sri Lanka, where we have 200 shipwrecks in the sea of Sri Lanka, where the divers come to explore that. So like that, we have a lot of things that we can offer to the world. It will create atmosphere in the country, it will create a situation in the country where we can give a very good boost with all that to the economy, and it will benefit the country and all the other nationalities.
Thank you so much. Can we have a response to this from Cambodia?
Thank you so much for the question. It is an impeccable question that I would like to answer. It's terrific. We have done a lot of efforts and endeavors to promote and market Cambodia as the destination. So the intercultural dialogue is very meaningful that we need to continue and go on with this kind of dialogue. Why? Because, you know, tourism is a sensitive industry. When everyone heard about terrorism, about war, about disease proliferation, and people scared to go. So we as the country that we was in genocidal regime, so we have tried to work very hard under the wisdom and brilliant leadership of our Prime Minister, so we have come to this day. However, I would like to mention one word. It always never be disadvantage, but always advantage. When you hear something, you know, I've been traveling around the world. People, when I tell people that I'm from the Kingdom of Cambodia, where is it? Is it Thailand? I said, no, Cambodia. So you know what happened? And next they said, is it Vietnam? I said, no. It in the middle. And then it happened to see that the people in the world know for two things. I think maybe how for, I would like to ask you the question, how you would know Cambodia if you've never been traveling around the world. But this is very interesting thing that come to my mind, to my heart. If they don't know Cambodia, they know Khmer Rouge, the killing field. It's a kind of message that pop in the people's mind. The bad thing also promotes you too. Another thing is our former king, Sihanouk. So when people speak, I speak that, okay, King Sihanouk, oh, okay, I know, I know. See, they don't know my country, but they know my king. He is excellent ambassador to the world. People know him, especially for the Francophonie, Pays Francophonie. So then, see, we have done a lot of effort through this. So when we start having tourism revitalized in late 1990s, it was a pity for Cambodia. Cultural heritage, we try to restore it because, you know, our flag, national flag, it's from the temple, Angkor Wat. We put the temple as our temple. So it means the heart, the love, the care, the concern of Cambodia. The culture. The cultural heritage is the utmost treasure thing that we need to preserve. Not only by word, but we put as the identity. So we have done a lot of marketing and promotion. We seek assistance from all international organizations, example like UNWTO, UNDP, ADB, to help us in everything. After Khmer Rouge, Cambodia has nothing. Intellectual scholars were executed. Not many people left with higher education. We're really grateful to the Soviet Union. My people also come to Baku to study. So then we try to do the soft infrastructure development first. At the same time, we need friends from around the world to help us. So in addition, I go back a little to the cultural heritage preservation. We were seeking assistance. Please allow me not to mention about who. To restore, to conserve our temple, thousands of years built. I think some of them like 2,000 years built. So then, at the time, Cambodia was sanctioned. Not as strong as North Korea, but some sort of. So when we asked them, assistance to restore the temple, we were rejected. We were rejected. So that's why today we have the UNWTO under your wise leadership. I'm really grateful that we can bring all the country in the world together to talk policy making or regulation or international convention, so on and so forth. So we have done a lot, how to convince people that Cambodia is secure, safe country and as a destination. Cambodia have Angkor Wat. It's not about the destination of Angkor Wat itself, but about the hospitality, authentic experience that tourists can experience, the warm, smiling people from the heart, not the fake smile. Or you learn how to smile, but we got our smile more adorable. Thank you. I think my answer to your question. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. You can see how your passion is very much appreciated. Thank you so much. I was asked something about, is it legitimate to use tourism
as part of a bigger or a more encompassing agenda. Certainly, and by all means, certainly. Tourism becomes relevant when it is relevant to other aspects of life. You know, we have here two or three examples of countries that have been suffering from terrible events in our lifetime, and they were able to change their image completely through using tourism to foster that agenda. When you talk about Cambodia, its neighbor next to it that was referred to, Vietnam, we still remember that Vietnam 25, 30 years ago was torn between north and south. It was a killing field as well, another killing field. A country like Croatia, who would have believed that Croatia 15 years ago was engulfed in civil war between different religious and ethnic groups? Croatia today, when you say the word Croatia, all what you think about is beautifully how do you want to spend your best vacation? Colombia even, a country that until now is getting out of its civil conflict, yet it used tourism 10 years ago to build that purpose and that image. It's a different agenda. It's not an economic or tourism agenda. It's a political agenda. Colombia was engulfed in a drug war for many years and in a civil war between the FARC and the government forces. The government of Colombia decided that it will not wait to resolve these conflicts. I still remember when they used the motto at the time 10 years ago, they used the motto that says, the only risk is wanting to stay. So they acknowledged the fact that there is a risk in the air, but the risk is that you fall in love with Colombia and you stay there. And today, if you visit Colombia, we were in the city of Medellin that was ruled by Pablo Escobar 10 years ago, a drug lord. It's one of the most safe, beautiful, and visited cities in the world. But now I want to turn, if you don't mind, a question to Sheikh Hamai, particularly about this thing. How do you see, Sheikh Hamai, tourism serving a bigger agenda in a small country like Bahrain?
شكراً دكتور طالب. بعد ما قاله الصديق العزيز من كمبوديا عن سر المحبة في ترويج الأوطان، الإيمان بأن ما لدينا هو أجمل ما نقدمه للعالم، هو الجواب الكافي. لا توجد بلدان متخلفة، توجد بلاد تخلف أبنائها عن حبها. ونحن في البحرين نؤمن بهذه المقولة، رأينا الأمثلة وتكلمتم عنها، لن أزيد على شيئا ولا يفتى ومالك في المدينة بعدما قلته دكتور طالب عن أمثلة لدول عانت وقاست ثم غيرت الحال إلى مدن تستقطب وتقدم ويقع الزائر في حبها. لا نستطيع أن نقول أكثر من ذلك، نستطيع أن نقول أننا نحاول أن نتعلم من التجارب الأخرى ونحاول أن نطبق وأن نستفيد من الخبرات التي تزورنا ونزورها ونتعلم منها. الحياة دائما في تغير وفي تقدم وفي تطور مستمر. نحن نحاول أن نطور ما لدينا وأن نبني على أسس ثابتة، لا نبحث عن القفزات السريعة وإنما عن الاستمرارية. ولي شرف أن أكون في هذه الاستمرارية أو الاستدامة لأكون ممثلة للسياحة المستدامة، لذلك نحاول أن نؤسس لهذا المعنى. في البحرين لدينا متحف مفتوح يمتد 3.5 كيلومتر، هو نموذج للسياحة المستدامة. وحين حصلنا على قرض لإنشاء هذا المشروع أو لتمويله، كان الهدف لأنه يحقق التنمية المستدامة من خلال السياحة الثقافية. لا أستطيع أن أقول أكثر إلا أننا نحاول أن نقتدي بالتجارب الناجحة وأن نقدم ما يخصنا. لا نريد أن نكون شبيها لدول ناجحة، وإنما نبحث من الداخل عما نبني ونؤسس عليه.
شكرا جزيلا. شكرا. We have 5 more minutes. I'm going to use 3 and I'm going to give you 2. The 3 minutes I'm going to use here are to ask our friends in the Flanders, how do you think the project of developing ethical guidelines for visiting historic sites can can contribute to better understanding between people and better appreciation to our cultures?
That's a very good question, not so easy to answer. At the moment, we are maybe a couple of words about the current state of the project. We are in the process of selecting about 10 sites worldwide, 10 conflict sites, which we want to analyze more in depth, and we are looking at a balance both geographically and typologically, but I'm not going into more detail than that. What struck me particularly in preparing the project was the, if you allow me the terminology, the multi-ethnic dimension of the First World War. Until a couple of years ago, the First World War was really seen as the white man's war, excuse me for the expression. It was about soldiers from the UK, from Canada, from Australia, New Zealand. But all those soldiers who came from other countries, in those times often still colonies in the imperial systems of the beginning of the 20th century, the remembrance about the commemoration about the participation of their countrymen in the First World War was almost completely forgotten. So we have now seen a major reconnection happening between people living in those countries and what happened to their forefathers in Flanders fields during the First World War. I think it's absolutely crucial that sites which relate to conflicts, that they are seen and that they are treated with a certain amount of respect by those people who are visiting. And respect is something which you cannot teach from a distance. You have to experience it by yourself, by engaging, by letting yourself loose, if I may call it like that, on those sites, in those specific landscapes with connection to conflicts of the past. And one of the major projects which our government has been funding over the last couple of years is the complete revamping of the so-called Flanders Fields Museum in the city of Ypres. And you visited the museum secretary general a couple of years ago. And when people are entering the museum, they get basically the personal life story of a soldier from their country in the First World War. And it's through this personal connection, through this personal touch, that the message is brought home, that people are really living into the experience itself, and that says many, many more things than reading walls and walls full of historical notes or looking at maps. It's the personal story, the personal connection. I was particularly struck by the fact that so many people living in Belgium, living in Flanders, didn't have a clue about what happened 100 years ago on their own territory. So that's another element of the ethical way of looking at conflicts of the past.
Thank you so much. I have a personal association with that because I visited the Flanders, I visited these sites, and I didn't know anything about the stories that were told to me while they were there. It is a really very enriching kind of experience. And that's what makes us think that there are, history is a story, our culture is a story. And it takes tourism to become the publisher and the distributor of that story. Because without distributing it, without publishing any story, story has no meaning. And that's exactly what we heard from our friend here. You need to tell stories and you need to disseminate them to people. All right, I have 3 more minutes left and I'm going to monopolize them if you don't mind. Unless somebody has an urgent need to ask a question, I'm going to ask Louis Damori a question and then give the final question to my friend Abdel-Ghaffar. Louis, you have been connecting tourism to peace for a long time. Has it worked? What do you think can be a better agenda of utilizing the force and the power of tourism to achieve peace? And where do you see examples of success?
Oh, that's an excellent question, Taleb. And yes, I think it's not totally been achieved, but we're moving in that direction. You point out regularly how we have 1.2 million international travelers this past year. Every one of those travelers are meeting with people of other countries, and it's that what you might call citizen diplomacy, which is bringing people together so we appreciate one another as human beings, not with regards to our ethnic connection, our religious connection, whatever, but we're all human beings with the same needs, with the same aspirations. And I'm reminded of the quote of President Eisenhower. He said, people of the world want peace so much that eventually governments will have to get out of the way and let them have it. I think, and also as Gandhi said, if the people lead, eventually leaders will follow. And I think that leading is happening with citizens of the world meeting with one another, meeting with their hosts, guests and hosts, meeting with one another, seeing everything that they have in common. And if we can only foster that more, it is being fostered more by organizations like Hostling International with their Sleep for Peace and other organizations. Voluntourism is making a major, major contribution, and philanthropic tourism is another one. I'm reminded of the story of rural education and development. They have some 40 centers in Nepal, which are not only centers of learning and teaching young children, but they're community centers. They served a vital role during the period in Nepal when they had the earthquake. It was a center for communication among the people to come together and recover from that earthquake. I think tremendous things are happening with tourism, and I think the UNWTO, together with the WTC, what you have done in collaborating with one another has made a major impact on the world. And I think all of this will continue in the years ahead.
Thank you so much, Louis. Let me give the final question to Abul-Fas Karayev. Minister, you have been asked about a particular conflict that your country is engaged in. In spite of the conflict, and in spite of the fact that the conflict is still alive, still active, you still have refugees from Nagorno-Karabakh that you have to take care of. In spite of all of this, you're thinking of tourism and promoting tourism. How do you reconcile the two issues together?
We are living in a very complicated world. And sometimes difficulties are stimulating us to find better solutions. Azerbaijan originally and traditionally is the country which always happy when it had guests. And I think that this is the basement of the tourism. I always joke about the hospitality of our people. I used to say that every poorest peasant in our villages will cut the head to the last chicken to feed the guest, because it is the natural approach. And I think that in spite of the difficulties, people still has very optimistic view for the future. The life is going on. We are happy to share our feelings, our happiness, our positive emotions with each other. That's why we consider that we are obliged to share that with the entire world. And that's why we consider that tourism is the biggest vehicle. Like you said, genius word about that the tourism is the publisher and promoter of the national heritage, national traditions, and the context from eye to eye to feel each other, to share feelings and maybe meals together, brings you to the absolutely new level of understanding and neighborhood. We will never hurt the people who we know personally. We will never tell anything bad about those who we know and whose experience and culture we felt. And we need this in our world. Yes, we have difficulties, but we are happy nations, we are happy people living in this country with the tolerance, understanding, multiculturalism, and we are ready to share with the entire world. These are two feelings which are enriching each other. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I couldn't have asked for a better way of ending this session. I still, however, have two small little items. One is to go back to your story. I missed saying that when we were in Sri Lanka, my wife and I, we had a wonderful, charming princess with us in Sri Lanka as well. So the question is, how does a charming princess from Jordan keep on her left wrist two pieces of ropes that were given to her 6 months ago, 7 months ago in Sri Lanka, in memory of that. That's a question that she should answer. Not now, later. Yes. Our good friends from the Flanders reminded us of the value of respect. We're celebrating this year, 2017, the International Year of Sustainable Tourism for Development. It's a very important occasion. On that occasion, we at UNWTO have produced a little video, a one-minute video that I want to share with you. This one-minute video was produced by our people in our house. It was not given to any agency. And this video is for you to use. You can co-brand it. You can put your logo on it. You can do whatever you want to do on it. And it ends with a very important motto: travel, enjoy, respect. Please, can we have the video? No, no, we need the sound. Anita and technology don't go together. Maybe you need an archaeologist. Yes, maybe, maybe. The picture is fine, but the sound is. Yeah, I know. Okay, now we have 4 or 5 experts working on that. Okay. No. All right. Okay.
We had it.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are relieved from your mission there. Thank you so much, everybody. We'll see you soon. No problem. Thank you so much. Thank you.